So, in this box, we've got something that every solar panel owner should have. It's an MPPT charge controller. This one made by MPP Solar Incorporated, and it's the 12 volt 25 amp model, the MCP3012, which arrived today, and I thought I'd do an unboxing, so let's try and slit this open using the official Finnish stabbing weapon, the Puukko, and have a look inside. It comes fairly well packaged, although the box has a slight tumble to it, which I don't quite like. They also did write a value of 30 euros on it, on the box and on the official invoice, despite the unit being worth about three times as much. So that could be of use to somebody else who is buying this. And here is the box. Model number PCM3012. Oh, I got it wrong the first time. 12 volts DC, 25 amps, 300 watts, 15 to 50 volts. Read instruction before operation. Pretty bland box. What do we get inside? We get a user manual. MPPT solar charge controller of 25 amps version 1.2. I recall YouTuber R&T Preppers doing a review of this unit maybe a year ago, and he made some note about the firmware of this unit being somewhat lacking. So it's going to be interesting to see if the firmware in this unit, which is obviously a year newer, is going to be any better. The manual seems to be of okay quality. Nothing too exciting. Doesn't seem to have any ridiculous chunky English in it. So, here is the unit itself, and some mounting screws. Do we get anything else? Nope. So it comes with some cardboard sides and a bit of bubble wrap, pretty sparse. But on first touch, this unit seems very solid. Surprisingly solid. It's quite heavy. I'd say it weighs about 1 kilo. The top is made out of plastic. This is not a real heatsink, it's just plastic for show. Little screen protector, multiple function display. Seems like that's a blue LED, that's a green LED, that's something else LED. Button that works. Some instructions. I do wonder how you set the custom charge profile with what appears to be a single button interface. Anyway, on the back side we've got the proper heat sinks, big one, small one, some mounting brackets here. You're probably supposed to hang it on a wall like that. Nothing too exciting. Seems they intended to put rubber feet on it, but they didn't put them in. And that's pretty much it. Very unexciting. It seems these connections are just a normal electrical installation connection bar with screws that they've placed inside the case. You can see the white plastic inside. And we do have some form of data port on it. Perhaps that's how you're supposed to configure the last profile, although you didn't get any cable inside. Let's tear this off. Always feels nice. And try and pair it on.
If there is any abnormal situations occur which doesn't list above, please call the service people immediately for professional examine.
So, before we get on to that, I thought we'd just have a quick bit more detailed look at the manual you get with the unit, because frankly it's not really what I'd like to see bundled with a unit like this. Now you do get a reasonable overview of what's what on the unit, a lot of reasonably funny warnings, specs for the two different models. There's a 24 volt model as well, which is pretty much the same but with a bit bigger heatsink. They give you fairly good instructions in good English on how to mount the unit on a wall and how to connect it to your batteries and your load and so forth, but what they don't give you is any information about how to actually use the unit. You do get a functional table for how you're supposed to use the single button interface, which is good. You seem to only get three settings: backlight on, battery type, turn, mute the alarm, aside from probably some power button feature. But you don't get any information on the custom charging profile, and this option is self-defined bulk floating voltage via bundled software, and we didn't get any bundled software, so I'm assuming that feature just isn't implemented yet. As for the predefined battery settings, you do get a pretty good settings for the lead acid batteries anyway. You get 14.3 volts bulk charge, and you get to choose between 13.2, 13.4 and 13.7 volts float charge, so that should be pretty sufficient for most lead acid battery systems. But it would be pretty nice to be able to self-define something for you if you want to float your batteries at 15 volts, hey, that's up to you. So, kind of disappointed in that. But the manual is in very good English for something that's obviously not been through a proper English manufacturing plant. This thing is entirely Taiwanese, and it's quite obviously a Taiwanese person who's written the manual. Okay, so now I've hooked the unit up. Well, almost. I've got my lead power supply acting as a 19 volt 3 amp solar cell, and I've got a 50 amp hour fully charged battery on the floor and an 8 amp load connected as well. So let's see what happens when we actually connect the battery. No sparks. But we do have a rather dim display. The unit makes a bit of a beeping noise, and they turn the load on automatically. So it's reading nothing from the panel. It says it's on charge profile number 1. Can we change that? Seems you have to hold the button down for a little one. It goes into charge profile number 5, even though we haven't configured it, so we're gonna have to see what that profile does. Can we get it back to number 1? Which should be the normal vented profile. So let's see what happens when we turn on my current limited power supply. And it's looking at the power supply, it seems to be oscillating slightly, but it's drawing 19 volts at pretty much 3 amps exactly. My power supply has very quick current limiting, and it becomes a very high impedance once it starts limiting, so it's not really an ideal solar panel surrogate, but it seems to do nicely. And this is what the meters on the power supply are telling me about the load the unit is putting. So it seems to set a current limit and then stick that limit for a little while, then open the circuit up to check the open circuit voltage of the panel, and then it turns the load back on. Which is how you would want an MPPT charge controller to do, because it can't track the maximum power point indefinitely without checking the open circuit voltage sometimes as well. So I'd give this unit a big thumbs up for the MPPT regulation. Now let's see what happens if we simulate a sunset by lowering the current limit a bit. It's doing an excellent job, actually. I was fully expecting this unit to freak out due to how high impedance my lamp power supply is when it's current limiting. Let's see how low a current we can go before it starts freaking out. There we go, it seems to begin to drag the panel voltage down somewhere around 250-300 milliamps. What happens if we go even lower? So this is practically an open circuit. The current limit is pretty much 1 or 2 milliamps, and it seems to be checking the panel, trying to draw a bit of current out of it once the voltage rises, so it seems to handle the sunset very well. So let's take a look at the sunrise. And it does indeed seem to track very well. That's the maximum current limit. So what happens if we increase the voltage of our panel? It should handle panels up to around 37 volts, I believe. Whoa! That it got a bit weird and spiked at a very high voltage. With a 41 volt panel, it seems to be doing a very good job. It's supplying power to our load, and it's charging our batteries at 3.5 amps. Now I've set my power supply to 48 volts, which is 2 volts below the absolute maximum open circuit voltage of a panel connected to this charge controller, and I will now turn the output on and see what it does. So the voltage drops down to 20 volts and it's slowly rising up, and it seems to have settled at around 29.8 volts, which is somewhat surprising. Oh no, and the voltage spiked up to 48 volts, and it seems to be regulating just fine. You can see my power supply there, 48 volts at around 4 amps. This regulator seems to be able to operate properly even above the specified 37 volt regulation, which is kind of surprising. I was expecting it to either drag the panel down or shut off. I'm not going to test any further over voltage conditions since I plan to use this unit for myself. Another thing to note about it is that it does not seem to be able to turn the load on or off. If I press the power button, I can turn the backlight on, and I can cycle through the charge profiles, and I can mute the alarm, but there seems to be no way of actually turning the load off. So you need to install an external switch. The manual furthermore recommends you do that. And now the charge controller has not entered flow charge mode. What on earth is going on? It just pulsed my battery up to 16 volts according to the meter. Either way, now it seems to have entered flow charge mode after giving my battery quite a ride for its money. So, now what on earth is going on? Why is it putting my battery up to such ridiculously high voltages? I wonder if it's actually true. And while I was messing around with it and disconnecting the solar panel circuit and load and stuff, I managed to make it malfunction, because we're measuring the solar panel input voltage, and as you can see, it's got 100 watts load, but it's not using any solar power whatsoever to charge the battery or run the load. So I'm gonna have to restart this unit. I'm kind of concerned it was that easy to make it malfunction. All I was doing was messing around here, glitching about with the solar panel. Okay, so we've concluded that this charge controller can handle overvoltage conditions quite well, at least within its spec. Now, let's see how it handles an overcurrent situation on the panel side. So what I've got hooked up here is two 12-volt batteries in series to give me a will appear to the charge controller as one very strong 24-volt panel. The regulator is supposed to limit the current to 25 amps anywhere, so these guys are going to be able to give a lot more than that, so let's see how it handles it. We are monitoring the battery voltage on the multimeter. And it gives us a fault 2. Fault 2 is an overload situation, so this unit apparently can't handle oversized panels very well. Let's try that again. So, from that we can see the panel wattage jumped up to 500 watts and then it shut off, so this unit can't handle two strong panels. And that might be a bit of a concern if you live in somewhere like I do, with in a pretty low sunlight area, and you want to have a huge array that can peak at a lot of current, but will average out at somewhere around a couple hundred watts. You can't hook up a huge array to this regulator and expect it to just use the power it wants. You're going to have to pre-regulate that if you want to do it. Thumbs down for that. Anyway, enough fuffing about. It's time to take this unit apart and see what it's made of. And it seems to come apart with these four screws in the corners of the unit, which do feel like plastic self-tappers, so yep, that's a bit of a thumbs down, but for the price you pay for this unit, you can't really expect much more. As I said earlier, the plastic seems to be of fairly good quality, so I'd expect these screws not to fail on you unless you do something very wrong while assembling it. They do seem to be pulling out small pieces of plastic threading when we take them out, so don't take my word for it. And once we've got that out of the way, you would expect the top cover to just pop off. And we get the insides. We've got four big capacitors, one small. Now these say Gemicon, but I'm kind of skeptical if they are genuine Gemicons. I have never seen that design on a Gemicon capacitor before. So I'm withholding judgment. These two other big ones are Eltec brand, which are known Chinese horrible capacitors, so I'd recommend replacing these if you want a really reliable unit. This one appears to be a general purpose Gemicon. This one's a Lylon. So yeah, nothing too exciting. But these are at least known brand capacitors, so you could do a lot worse. The front panel disconnects like that. and you can separate the unit. There's not a whole lot going on the front panel. I must say that the solder joints on this board look to be of extremely high quality. These are some of the best solder joints I've seen on a product from Asia in quite some time, so a big thumbs up for that. This panel is probably not going to fail for what it's worth. If we take a closer look at the main PCB, we've got what appears to be a row of FETs. We've got name brand FETs, International Rectifier FB4410Z. This whole row appears to be all the same. And on the other row we've got one STSTPS20H100CT, which is probably a 100 volt 20 amp dual rectifier, and some more FETs. Now I can't recognize the logo on those off the top of my head. They could be Infineon FETs, but I'm not entirely sure. The number on them is 95T07GP, and the lower number is 33028G. So that's probably a date code, 3308 or something like that. Furthermore, we've got an NTC here, which is probably some kind of temperature sensor. Some very interesting looking pin header, possibly for programming. The main processor with a sticker on it, 05779 says. What I'd assume is another transistor of some sort. The obviously two obvious very big toroidal chokes. This is of course a real MPPT charge controller. You wouldn't expect anything less for the price. And mostly just other passives, some coils, some more small caps, small transistors, all over. The wiring inside this unit is fairly thick, fairly nice. I like that. It should be able to handle 25 amps without problem on each one of these wires. They are 12 gauge wires. And this seems to be some kind of botch wire, or they just couldn't be bothered to make a proper trace thick enough to handle the current. What more, crystal, the PC interface port here, which apparently goes unused. There seems to be a 10-pin RJ45 connector, similar to those you find on APC UPSs. Perhaps you're supposed to use one of those cables for it. Strangely, they've used a ground-coloured cable for the load ground. So that's kind of weird. I suppose it's intended to be mains grounded, but still kind of weird that they'd use cable like that inside a unit that's built for DC. The heat sinks. These transistors are connected to a very thick solid piece of aluminium, which goes through to the top heatsink here. And these ones are connected to a less impressive but still pretty solid chunk of aluminium that goes to this heatsink here. Now, that solution, I don't quite know if I approve of it, because the heat of these transistors have to travel all the way across here to get to utilize the heatsink fully. And these heatsinks also seem to be built to allow some airflow both underneath and above, but it's blocked off by this heatsink, so that's not really optimal. However, during the testing I've done off camera, this unit doesn't seem to get very hot at all. So I doubt that's really a big concern. Let's get the PCB out and see if there's anything on the other side. On the bottom of the case we've just got the attachment screws for everything, including the big heatsink on the back. Now the bottom heatsink, well, the top little heatsink, seems to be a two-part deal, which is just screwed together with no thermal interface material whatsoever. So that's a bit of a thumbs down, but the surfaces are reasonably flat, so it shouldn't be too much of a problem. And again, this unit seems to be very efficient, so I doubt it's very necessary either way. However, really interesting stuff is on the bottom of the mainboard, because this is quite obviously where most of the magic happens. We've got lots of small surface mount transistors, lots of passives, a fair amount of diodes, and a fair amount of high current traces running here. We've got a fair amount of current shunts. These are definitely those, so if you want to hack this unit and make it handle more or less current, you probably want to touch these. If we take a closer look, the soldering quality on this board seems to be of very high class as well. So, a big thumbs up to MPP Solar for actually using a high quality factory to build a PCB of this thing. There are no really obvious cold joints. This one looks kind of iffy, but it's quite alright. And all the so-called normal joints are just very nice, very shiny, and everything just looks like a top quality PCB to me. It's obviously a multi-layer glass fiber board, as you'd expect in a reasonably high quality unit. Now if we take a look at the actual topology of this unit, we have our solar panel input coming straight into these two caps, and after those caps we have these two pairs of transistors, each driving one of these coils, making up our main DC to DC converters. And after those we have these two transistors making up an active rectifier, as well as this diode, dual 10 amp diode, making up a reverse polarity protection for our secondary caps, which are 1000 microfarad 35 volt caps, primary is 220 mic 80 volts. After that, we have this row of FETs handling the output switching and battery switching and so forth. We have two in parallel for each task. These two handling the switching of the output load. These two handling the switching of the battery to the DC-DC converter. And these two seem to handle the switching of the solar panel directly to the battery. Now this row is all negative side switched, so we would connect the negative input of the solar panel to the negative input to the battery. And the reason for that is if you just turn these FETs all on, then you just get a route straight from your solar input to your secondary here. And if your solar panel voltage is very low, it can just route the voltage coming from your solar panel directly into your battery, essentially turning it into a cheapo PWM controller if your solar panel voltage is too low to drive the DC to DC converter. So that's a very big thumbs up and a very smart design decision, because it means that this regulator can utilize your panels even if your panel voltage is just, say, half a volt over what your battery voltage is. And since these FETs are all very low resistance and very fast FETs, these are 7.2 milliohm FETs and these ones are 5 milliohm FETs, you're essentially not going to get a whole lot of voltage drop even if you're going through these very fat coils. Very smart decision on the part of the manufacturer. On the bottom, there's not much to say, except for noting that the current sense coils, current sense resistors, are very low value, 0.2 milliohms, and there are several paralleled up together for all the different sensors. It can sense, let's see, I believe this is the battery voltage, this is battery current, this should be the load current, This should be the panel current. And combined with a voltage sense somewhere in all this stuff, it can calculate the powers you get. So, this device has, since these are very low value resistors, extremely low, it probably doesn't have very accurate sensing, but it does have very low dropout voltage, so again, a very good decision for this unit to be efficient, which is primarily what you want in a solar panel regulator. Top efficiency no matter what. And everything is connected through with very thick traces, lots of via stitching going on, very low resistance in those traces, beautiful. And that's pretty much it. I'm not going to go into the logic side of things because it's essentially just a blob in this processor taking care of everything. But from a DC to DC converter standpoint, for this application, this is an extremely good design. Now, I can't speak for how good more expensive commercial grade solar panel regulators are by comparison, but for what this is, and really, if I were to design one of these things, I'd probably do pretty much what they've done here. Granted, I'm not an electronics designer, I'm just some nerd in the basement. All in all, very good design. I really like the insides of this unit. Only downside I can say is these two and this cap are LTEC or Lelon, whatever, caps which are known to be unreliable if used incorrectly. However, since the designer of this device seems to be very competent, perhaps they have chosen high-end capacitors from that company which are not going to fail on you. But yeah, I don't trust this company, not Lelon, so I'm probably going to replace those at some stage. But if we connect it up with a very low voltage panel, it becomes clear that I was wrong in my guess about those FETs being used to connect the battery straight to the panel when the voltage is low, because the controller quite obviously just shuts down once the voltage goes right under 15 volts or so. Once we get above the turn-on threshold, however, it'll use everything the panel's got. So, thumbs up for that, even though it wasn't quite as good as I had hoped for. Another thing you might want to be concerned about when purchasing a charge controller like this is any high frequency noise it puts over your battery bank. And right now we're measuring right across the battery output of this unit with a 50 amp hour, fairly old, fairly worn out car battery attached. And we're at 200 millivolts per division, and we're getting pretty much one division of noise at a fairly low frequency. However, if we zoom in on this waveform, we can see that there is quite a lot of very high frequency noise. Now we are at 500 millivolts per division and 0.1 microseconds per horizontal division, and we've got 1.5 volts of peak-to-peak ripple over our battery at somewhere around 20 megahertz or so, which shouldn't be too much of a problem, but it might be something to keep in mind if you've got very sensitive loads. A positive side to this could be that this might act as a little bit of a desulfation device or cell balancing device for your batteries, since it does send very short pulses through your batteries at a fairly high frequency. These pulses only come once for each of these little pulses. So it's not a huge amount of noise, but it's fairly high in amplitude. Good thing, bad thing, nobody really knows. I wouldn't complain about it anyway. Now, since this is an MPPT, maximum power point tracking charge controller, it needs to keep a track on the state of your panels, even though you don't have any load on them. And I've noticed the way it does that is by simply dumping all the power your panels have got into your battery. And this isn't normally a problem if you've got a bit of load on your battery, it'll just let the voltage stay within a normal range, but in a situation like this, where you simply have no load in a very small battery, well, you could see the voltage spike to over 18 volts. And that's not really ideal. So you need to keep in mind that when you use one of these charge controllers, that you should have a small load on it, or have a reasonably sized battery bank. I'd say anything over 100 amp hours should be able to handle it. But anything smaller than that, and you actually risk throwing the charge controller into overvoltage or overcharge protection mode and turn off the battery charger, also without turning the load off. So there's a decent chance of actually damaging your batteries by simply using too small a battery and too light a load. Now, the audible alarm on the controller does sound when this happens, and it seems to reset after some time, but I can't say for certain whether or not that's always the case. It seems to do this panel check anything between every 15 seconds to every few minutes. I've tried to time it, and it just seems to do it whenever it feels like it. There it goes again. 19 volts in our poor little battery. And there we go. It just kicked into an overcharged condition and turned the charger off. We can see it on the display. It says fault 1, which according to the manual is overcharge. You can mute the alarm, and it should reset after some time. And there we go, it reset and tried to charge the battery again. That took around a minute or so, and it didn't seem to have triggered the overcharge alarm this time around. But yeah, you need to keep that in mind. This charge controller might overcharge your batteries briefly if you've got too light a load or too small batteries. While setting up the efficiency testing jig and hooking all meters up, I just tried to disconnect the battery while everything's still operating, and the unit did not shut off, which I believe it is supposed to. The terminal voltage jumped up to 14.2 volts according to the meter, which makes sense since the load is drawing slightly more than it was a moment ago. And it just doesn't notice that I've taken the battery out. It still thinks the battery's okay. So I don't know if that's a good thing or not. Certainly the battery good LED should not be on. So let's see what happens if we take the power away from it. Oh, that didn't look very good. Got quite a bit of voltage drop there. Yeah. It has no idea I've disconnected the battery. And there it realised it and shut off. Was I got the power limit down for enough? Yeah. Something to consider. It does not seem to like hot swapping batteries, and it could potentially damage your load by trying to drive it straight off a panel. Because that outreach voltage coming out of that thing probably was not very clean, and if a cloud passes by, you could get huge voltage drops and spikes. You could see how the light just dimmed when I changed the panel surrogate characteristics. So, that's a bit of a thumbs down, really. It should be able to know when your battery's in. Alright, efficiency. What everybody wants to know, and here's the test jig I've used for measuring the efficiency of this unit. I've got my panel surrogate here, which is running through this power resist in order to smooth out the current limit, which is very hard and makes the controller confused. But we've got our input current measurement on the panel there, since the current is the same going through a resistor, that is not a problem. But we need to measure the panel voltage, which this meter is doing, The low battery notification came on while I was doing measurements, but it's still measuring alright. And we are measuring our battery current here. Positive numbers indicate that current is going into the battery, negative that current is going out. And this meter is currently measuring the voltage drop between the positive terminal of the battery and the load terminal, to which an 8.85 amp car headlight is connected. I've verified that it draws that much current. I'm at the pretty much 13.2 volts we get across it. Let's see. Yeah, 13.18. And I've crunched the numbers, and this is what we end up with. So I should note that I allow the entire system to stabilize for around half an hour before taking these measurements, and all the values have been fairly stable throughout. So what we got was the unit was drawing 126.8 watts out of my 31.6 volt panel, and the load was drawing 116.55 watts, and 1.19 watts was going into the battery, which leaves us with a loss of 9.06 watts in the actual charge controller, and an efficiency of 93% in this particular configuration. And that's pretty impressive. The controller is specified for, I believe, 97%, well, up to 97%, so 93% is pretty much what you'd expect after out of something with such a ridiculous rating. I somewhat doubt it's ever going to reach that quoted 97%, but 93% is quite a bit better than what you'd get if out of a cheap PWM controller, for instance, where you'd lose 30% by just dropping the voltage off your panel. I also measured the total voltage drop between the battery terminals and the load terminals, since this inverter controller simply parallels up your battery and your load. You are going to get a slight voltage drop from your battery to your load, and that drop was a total on the positive and negative side of 0.588 volts, or which equals a resistance inside the box of 6.4 milliohms, which is quite respectable. You don't get any huge losses by using the load connection on this thing rather than just connecting things straight out to your battery. Now that could be worth noting. If a lesser controller could have some cheap MOSFETs and long tracers going around, and you could end up with several watts of loss inside the controller by just using the integrated load connection rather than going straight to your battery. And as for the accuracy of the meters, it's drawing 126 watts out of the panel, and it's jumping around between 125 and 128, which is quite accurate. And it's measuring a 116 watt load as 113 watts, which is, again, respectable. Well within the tolerances I'd expect out of a unit like this. However, the battery charging current meter seems to be quite a bit off, at least at low currents, because this meter is measuring the current going into the battery at around 100 milliamps, but the controller wants to say that it's 600 milliamps. So there's something a bit iffy with that. Could probably have to do with how it simply connects your battery straight to your load, and that its load resistors inside aren't configured quite optimally for that configuration. However, I would wager that once you actually get up to higher currents, the meter will be more accurate, since we are dealing with quite low current right now. As for the battery voltmeter, it seems to strike fairly close to home with a reading of 13.2 equaling 13.238 on the proper meter. My unit seems to measure just a bit too high when the voltage goes up, but I haven't observed any difference between the real value and its displayed value of more than around 0.1 volts, so That's okay. Nothing too spectacular.
Yeah, the battery current meter seems to be quite rough in general on this unit. Right now it's showing 7.6 amps.
When the real value is 8.8.
So, this value shouldn't be used as more than a guideline. But, on the rough, I suppose it's okay. Strangely, just after I stopped filming that, the meter jumped up to 8.8 amps, when the actual current is 9 amps. So I'm not entirely sure what's going on with that. This meter seems to be doing something wrong. It could be a software problem that it doesn't round properly, or there's too much ripple inside of a unit for it to measure properly all the time. Either way, mine seems to have gotten quite a bit more accurate right now.
As for the power consumption of this unit, while the solar panel is not connected or it's very dark outside, it seems to be around 100 milliamps with the backlight on and 100 milliamps with the backlight off. And after some time, the unit will enter a sleep mode where it uses around 13 milliamps. If you turn the solar panel back on, the unit automatically starts with the backlight on and will begin to charge the battery as soon as it's gotten started. This display, as far as just giving you some general information on the state of your system, I'd say it's pretty usable, but it isn't a precision instrument, but you wouldn't expect that out of a tool like this. You're supposed to have a proper multimeter if you're going to be doing the maintenance of your system yourself. So, in closing, what can you say, or what can you tell about the MPP Solar PCM-3012 Solar Charge Controller? Well, for starters, it surprised me a great deal with its very good build quality. I mean, this is a very high quality, almost industrial quality unit. The only complaint I would say I have for the build quality is that it uses a few not very good quality capacitors, but for the price point, I'd say that is definitely forgivable. Furthermore, it seems to track panels extremely well, and despite being specified for tracking up to 37 volts, mine tracks up to 48 volts, and I haven't dared trying anything higher. So, if you're brave, you could try hooking up a higher voltage system than even 48 volts and hope for the best. The input capacitors are 80 volt rated, and the input FETs are 100 volt rated, so there's a decent chance it'll work with even higher voltage panels, but nobody's going to guarantee that works for you. I really like the charge presets on it as well, even though you can't set the custom charge preset since the PC interface is entirely useless. You don't get a cable, and I don't even know if the software in it can handle it, but the presets are pretty good. You can change, well, you can practically just change your floating voltage between 13.2, 13.5 and 13.7 volts, I believe, which should be enough flexibility for most lead-acid battery systems. Can't speak for the nickel-cadmium preset because I don't know enough about nickel-cadmium batteries. In a way, it's got very good load regulation. It doesn't put a whole lot of ripple and noise on your batteries, but the ripple and noise it does put on could arguably, if you really want to make a good thing about it, be said to be a diesel fission feature, because it does pulse a fairly high, maybe 1 or 2 volts above the mean voltage, short pulses over your battery, so it does send some very short high current pulses through your battery, which could potentially help your batteries if they're suffering from sulfation. But yeah, you're pretty much stretching it if you want to call that a good thing. Ideally it should have no ripple and noise on the output as well. Unless it's advertised and intended, you should buy a separate diesel fator or load balancing device. It also has pretty good efficiency, 93% was what I measured with a 36-ish volt panel surrogate, and you can't complain about that. It's far better than a PWM controller, and for the price I'd say it's definitely worth it. The efficient can probably furthermore be a bit higher if you use it under some ideal circumstances, but I'm not going to spend my time trying to figure out what those exact circumstances are. Perhaps it can actually do that mythical 47% that they talk about in the manual, but I don't know. I do, however, have a big list of negative for this unit as well. Above all, the firmware in it is not very good. I've just had it for maybe a day and a half, and I've been experimenting with it while I've been shooting this video, and I've on several occasions managed to make it lose the panel. I put a voltage on the panel input and it doesn't do anything with the power. It just says 0 watts going out of the panel. It keeps on running on batteries. Now, I don't know if it's ever going to find the panel again if that happens, but it's a kind of major concern if your solar charge controller suddenly stops using your panel. And what makes it even more concerning is that it's always been when I've been disconnecting the panel, say when I've been moving some cables around. So potentially this charge controller could not start up when the sun rises, and who knows for how long that could go on. You could end up running your batteries entirely dead before you find out. And that's a really bad thing, a really, really bad thing. So big thumbs down for that. It also has no way of dealing with a panel that can put out too much current, so you can't hook it up to an oversized array just in case, because it will just go beep at you and shut off. So you really need to limit your input power to what this unit is rated for. Bit of a letdown there. I was hoping I could be able to use this thing as both a spare and a battery charger once I upgraded to a 24 volt system sometime in the future, but that's obviously not going to happen, since, well, hook a 24 volt battery to the solar input and it shuts down. But as long as you're able to size your panels not to be too big, not to be too small, well, this unit should do quite alright. And something that bothers me quite a bit as a nerd is that it comes with a proprietary PC port. It doesn't have an Ethernet interface in it. It doesn't have any transformer for that, so this is some kind of serial or USB interface, which they don't provide a cable for and don't provide software for. So I doubt it's even implemented. And while it is nice to see that they are maybe preparing for future updates, R&T Preppers, who made a video on this thing a year ago, complained about the same thing, and a year later they still haven't started shipping data stuff with it. So I would want to see that happening with this unit, because being able to use it with a PC for monitoring or setting that mysterious custom preset, it would be a very nice feature, but you're not going to get it at the current state. However, it does have a nice programming header, probably, inside, so who knows, maybe you can hack your own firmware for it if you really want to. And another very small issue I have with this unit is that it does have a buzzing noise to it. I don't know if you've been able to hear it during the video, but it has a buzzing noise. Around 200-300 hertz or so. It's not too loud, but if you're going to sit right beside this, it's probably going to get on your nerves after a while. At least it would definitely get on mine. And the display is kind of hard to read from any angle that isn't head on. On the plus side, the backlight is very good. It's very even and very easy to read. Probably easier to read with a naked eye than with a camera, because the camera tries to expose with the black background, but yeah.
That's a pretty easy to read panel. Works a lot better from the upside than the underside. It cuts out at maybe around 45 degrees. However, what isn't good about the panel backlight is that if you're using the single button interface, it's pretty easy to accidentally try and change your battery charging profile, especially when you get an alarm condition and you're trying to mute the unit because you're supposed to hold the button down to mute it, but you're also supposed to hold the button down in order to change charging profile. So that's a bit of a concern. You need to keep an eye on this number while you're using the unit, especially if you've just reset an alarm, because you could, if you've got gel batteries, you could easily get it into nickel-cadmium mode or vented into sealed, which is just a step up in float voltage, but that could prove devastating. It could reduce the efficiency of your batteries and make your electrolyte toppings way more frequent. But these are really all very minor complaints. For a unit that costs $150 delivered to your door, plus any applicable tax, you can't really ask for more. On the grand scheme of things, this thing gets a thumbs up so big it's trying to escape out of the frame. I can't do anything but recommend this unit. The build quality alone makes it worth it, because that just, as a hardware guy, that just makes me want to smile until I'm crying. This thing is not made in China, and it rarely shows. So, that is probably everything I've got to say on this thing. Thank you for watching. I hope you find the video useful in selecting a charge controller, and cheerio!